Thank you, Reverend Burt. The next item of business is consideration of Business Motion 2650 in the name of George Adam on behalf of the Parliamentary Bureau on a change to today's business. Any member who wishes to speak against the motion should press their request to speak button now. And I call on George Adam to move the motion.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. I'm moved.
Thank you, Minister. No member has asked to speak against the motion. Therefore, the question is that motion 2650 be agreed. Are we all agreed?
Yes.
The motion is therefore agreed. The next item of business is topical questions, and in order to get in as many people as possible, I'd appreciate short and succinct questions and responses. And I call it question number one, Neil Bibby.
Explain its decision to increase peak and off-peak regulated fares by 3.8%.
Minister Graham Day.
Presiding Officer, I can assure members the decision was not taken at all lightly. Significant analysis was carried out both by ScotRail and Transport Scotland to look at various options for rail fares. The cost of delivering rail services must be met at a time when passenger numbers remain well below pre-COVID levels. Fiscal prudence makes an inflation-linked fare increase unfortunately necessary. Now, I hear calls from others about fare freezes or offering free travel to entice people back to rail. Unfortunately, none of these suggestions come up with any recommendations on how to fund them.
Neil Bibby.
Presiding Officer, Scotland faces a climate crisis, so what impact will fare hikes have on passenger growth and modal shift? Scotland faces a cost of living crisis, so why rule out a fare freeze to keep costs down for commuters? And why hike fares in January when even the Tories are waiting until March? After months of industrial unrest with the rail unions and now with the fare hikes about to hammer passengers, our railways face a leadership crisis under this Transport Minister. So will he explain how his fare hikes are compatible with action on the climate emergency and the soaring cost of living faced by commuters?
Minister.
Presiding Officer, as I made clear, this is a regrettable situation, but a necessary one that we find ourselves in. Just to outline for the Chamber, applying no increase or an increase below RPI was considered, but with a cost of between 6.5 million and 9.1 million involved, those options could not be taken forward, especially as such a decision would have had a cumulative impact, the impact recurring annually in future years. And we have to ensure that rail fares are affordable for the taxpayer as well as passengers. We need to have a rail service that's financially sustainable. And whilst the government covers the majority of the cost of rail passenger services, fares do have to contribute to overall funding. And I recognise the point about trying to encourage people back onto rail as part of tackling the climate emergency. It's an important one, but we also have to make rail sustainable from a financial perspective as well. And we are in difficult situations at the moment.
Neil Bibby.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. Scotland's railways do face a leadership crisis under this government. The Transport Minister, in a written parliamentary answer to me issued on Thursday, said his fare strategy remained under consideration. On Friday, a matter of hours later, the Minister announced to the nation his brutal 3.8% fare hike. When was the decision actually taken to increase fares? And does the Minister really expect the travelling public to believe the answer he gave to me on Thursday is remotely credible?
Minister.
Presiding Officer, as I've made clear, a very great deal of consideration was being given over an extended period to the necessity to introduce a fares increase. And I, as I said earlier, I wish it wasn't necessary, but I'm afraid it is.
Bill Kidd.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. Minister, ScotRail's current range of discounts reducing the cost of travel for passengers has been working to promote travel by train before the arrival of Omicron. How does the SNP's record in government of supporting affordable travel compare with the rest of the UK? And can I ask that, given that we still need trains to run over the festive period and going forward, what advice can the Minister give to encourage safe travelling?
Minister Graham Day.
Presiding Officer, it is a fact that the Scottish Government's approach to rail fare costs has ensured that the average fare remains 20% cheaper than across the rest of the UK. But I want to pick up particularly Bill Kidd's point about the current situation. ScotRail is doing all it can to manage cancellations whilst affected staff follow isolation rules. Unfortunately, that situation changes by the hour. We would encourage passengers to plan their journeys, taking account of the latest operator updates and Scottish Government guidance. And I would also appeal to passengers to please follow all the basic COVID protection measures to protect both themselves, fellow passengers and, of course, staff.
Graeme Simpson.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. Thanks, Presiding Officer. I just want to put to the Minister that he may want to re-look at how we do fare increases, have a look at the ticketing settlement agreement, perhaps peg increases to the consumer price index rather than the retail price index, because we cannot go on like this.
Minister.
Presiding Officer, I could, of course, point out that this is an almost identical rise to the one that's been introduced in England by the Conservatives, but I don't want to do that. I want to accept that Mr Simpson is trying to engage constructively on this issue, and in that spirit, I'd be happy to meet him and discuss these matters.
Thank you. I move on to question two, and I call Stephen Kerr.
To ask the Scottish Government what actions it will take in response to the 2020-2021 audit of its consolidated accounts by the Auditor General for Scotland.
Minister Tom Arthur.
I welcome the Auditor General's opinion on the accounts. This is the 16th consecutive year that the accounts have received an unqualified opinion, demonstrating the Scottish Government's sound and transparent management of the country's finances. The financial position reported in the accounts has been taken into account in the subsequent budget process. There are aspects where action has already been taken and is in progress. However, the Scottish Government will, of course, consider and respond to all audit recommendations and report on agreed actions. The report will, I understand, be considered by the Public Audit Committee in January, and the Scottish Government will respond to the committee's interest in any aspect of the report, which is wide-ranging.
Stephen Kerr.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. Describing the Auditor General and Audit Scotland as the opposition is not a good look for the Cabinet Secretary for Finance or the Deputy First Minister. The Cabinet Secretary seems to have been busying herself claiming that the rest of us just don't understand the numbers. Well, I'm more than satisfied that the Auditor General understands the numbers, and I hope she does too. And he says that there are £580 million of an underspend for the 2020-21 year. So will the Minister tell us straight, because it should be an easy answer, what specific amounts of funding and which specific departments and projects this £580 million has now been allocated to? In short, where's the money?
Minister.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. Firstly, what I would say to Stephen Kerr is I do not recognise the remarks that he attributes to the Deputy First Minister or the Cabinet Secretary for Finance and the Economy. And I would assure the Member and Parliament that this Government has absolute respect for all of the work that Audit Scotland carries out. In regards to the second questions, I would refer him to the statement I gave to Parliament 6 months ago on the provisional outturn, or to the budget document that was published for this current financial year, where the majority of that underspend was carried forward. And if he seeks further guidance on the matter, I suggest he looks behind him to Liz Smith, who I wrote to following the provisional outturn statement and provided further detail following that statement in the summer.
Stephen Kerr.
I note that he wasn't able to answer that specific question. So what else do we learn from this report? That £45 million of EU funds have been lost due to Scottish Government failures and are having to be paid from the Scottish Government accounts, that hundreds of millions of taxpayers' pounds have been wasted by the SNP on bailout projects, which, quote, have not delivered expected outcomes and are, quote, unlikely to achieve value for money. The Auditor General said it was essential that the Scottish Government learn lessons from these significant failures. So will the Minister tell the Chamber what lessons he has learned?
Minister.
Well, of course, we listen closely and study closely all recommendations made by the Auditor General. And as I stated in my answer to Mr Kerr's original question, my understanding is that the Public Audit Committee will consider this report early in the new year. And of course, we will monitor closely and study closely and listen closely to what the Public Audit Committee has to say. With regards to where funds have been allocated, I appreciate that Mr Kerr is relatively new to this Parliament, but I would just restate again that the underspend, the majority of it, was anticipated. And of course, we have a process of autumn budget revisions and spring budget revisions where money is allocated. And indeed, with regards to aspects of the underspend to which he refers, that was further detailed to the Public Finance Administration Committee last month by myself when moving the autumn budget revision. And you will find full details in the official report and these documents also published in the Scottish Government website, which I'm sure will provide some very stimulating and engaging and informative reading for Mr Kerr over the Christmas period.
Question number three, Alex Rowley.
Presiding Officer, to ask the Scottish Government what action it's taken to address any workforce issues in social care in light of comments from the Chief Executive of Scottish Care that the social care sector is facing the biggest workforce crisis it has ever experienced.
Minister Kevin Stewart.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. The Scottish Government is fully committed to improving the experience of the social care workforce as we recognise and value the work they do. As part of the £300 million NHS care winter package, we announced an increase in wages for our adult social care workforce, delivering direct care to £10.02 per hour from the 1st of December 2021. And we will increase it again next year, an announcement made as part of the Scottish Budget, the minimum hourly rate of £10.50 per hour. This represents an increase of 12.9% for lower paid workers in the course of a year. In collaboration with partners, we are working to attract more people to the sector, and we launched a national marketing campaign on the 8th of November. This campaign is doing things differently to previous campaigns, focusing on social media, a younger target audience, and working with schools and colleges. The campaign links to other work we're doing with the Scottish Social Services Council and NHS Education for Scotland on career pathways and learning and development. We've also funded the My Job Scotland recruitment website so that all social care vacancies can be advertised in one place and at no additional cost to all third and independent sector organisations. I'd like to put on record my thanks for the remarkable job that those working in social care have done throughout the pandemic, and I have no doubt they will continue to do that over the course of this winter.
Alex Rowley.
I thank Mr Stewart for the answer, and I think we would also want to join him in putting on record our sincere thanks to everybody that's working on the front line in this sector just now. Donald McCaskill, the Chief Executive of Scottish Care, warned a committee of this Parliament recently. He said the sector is now hemorrhaging staff to better paid and less successful jobs in retail, stressful jobs in retail and hospitality. The coming months will see more and more providers going to the wall. So whilst I welcome the £10.50 that was announced, does he accept that actually that's not enough? And unless we tackle low pay in this sector and increase it substantially, we won't tackle the problems that we're facing in social care?
Minister.
Well, the government takes all of this very seriously, and that's why we have funded two wage increases in a very short period of time. But let me compare the situation now compared to when Labour was in power, because at that point, the minimum pay for care workers was £5.30 at five an hour. That's now £10.50 from April under this government. It's not as much as we'd like, but it's still 96.2% more than under the previous Labour administration. And I have to say that Mr Rowley should take cognizance of that fact and ask himself why Labour didn't do more to increase the pay of social care workers while they were in power.
Alex Rowley.
already welcomed the increase that has taken place, but I've made clear that I don't believe it's enough. I think people will be dismayed to see Mr Stewart try to play party politics on such a serious issue. Can I quote for Dr Andrew Buse, the BMA Scotland GP committee chair? He said, "We must do something to support the social care workforce. Otherwise, the burden that they will create on the rest of the system will take down anything else we try to do." So will he accept that whilst massive progress has been made, it is not enough if we do not tackle the low pay within social care? We can't tackle the problem. And will he therefore make representations direct to the Finance Secretary to bring forward a further increase to tackle this issue?
Minister.
Well, I'm glad that Mr Rowley recognises that there has been a massive change here and an improvement. This government will continue to do all that it can to ensure that we are paying people fairly. And we have our Fair Work Group looking at pay across the social care sector. And we have said in our National Care Service consultation that not only will we look at pay, that we will look at conditions in the sector. And of course, we want to ensure that there is care progression so that we can attract new people to enter the care profession. As for discussions with the Cabinet Secretary for Finance, I know that Mr Rowley often doesn't have much faith in terms of the negotiations that there are with the Cabinet Secretary with Finance from his own colleagues. But I would suggest that he may wish to ask his finance spokesperson to discuss with the Cabinet Secretary what further ways there are forward in this front.
Willie Rennie.
I think carers and vulnerable people listening to the Minister will be severely disappointed with his partisan tone this afternoon. Carers in my constituency, they tell me directly they are at breaking point. They tell me that vulnerable people right now are going without visits whatsoever, without medication, without food and without showering. That is not a situation that we should have in a modern Scotland. What practical steps is the Minister going to take today to deal with this crisis that we face right now? No partisan politics, just practical steps.
Minister.
The government are taking practical steps every single day of the week to try and help health and social care partnerships and local authorities get this right for people. Because Mr Rennie is right in the fact that it is all about people and the care that they need and deserve. And that's why the Cabinet Secretary for Health and I are in regular discussions with health and social care partnerships, health boards and local authorities across the country in order to see what we can do to help alleviate any difficulties that they experience. I myself was on to Fife Health and Social Care Partnership, Council and Health Board only last week to discuss these issues around about delayed discharge and also to make sure that we get care right for people. And the Cabinet Secretary and I will continue to have these discussions and do all that we possibly can to improve the situation for people across the country.
That concludes